What's up, everybody? Thank you for checking me out. My name is Eko Simpson. I'm a Ghanaian, and I live in Ghana. Well, you are watching this channel because somebody introduced you to it. It was recommended or suggested to you on YouTube. Basically, my YouTube channel is to connect Africans in the motherland to Africans in the diaspora. So thank you for checking me out. If this is your first time of watching my videos, kindly subscribe to my YouTube channel.
I find myself in the midst of great men and women, and there is every danger that I may breach protocol. And for that very reason, permit me to recognize all the traditional kings who are here present in a manner that does not offend you. Therefore, I'll not name any of them, but I recognize you. Permit me also to recognize my dear sister, Dr. Arikana Chihombe-Kwao, and her dear husband who is present in this assembly, and the men and women who have crossed oceans to be present here in Ghana. There is a Somali say that unless your home is the mouth of a shark, everybody wants to come home. And that you are here confirms to me that your home is not the mouth of a shark. Sister Arikana and all those who have assembled here under the aegis of ADDI, permit me to congratulate you. Because what you have done is indicative of the deep-seated desire to liberate Africa from the chains of sorrow and want. And the choice of Ghana is as emblematic as it is symbolic. And in many ways, you are harbingers for a big storm that is coming to this part of the world. And Ghana, if you permit me, plays a critical part in the history of Africa. And I believe that the choice of Ghana was deliberate for that reason. When Ghana, on the 6th day of March 1957, became the first country to begin our continuing battle of exercising the ghost of the Curse of Berlin, the founding father of independent Ghana, Kwame Nkrumah, said that until the rest of Africa is free, the independence of Ghana means nothing. And I dare say that that gives meaning to the statement that we must be helped to fight our oppressors with all our mind and might. Yes. And we are assembled here to give meaning to those words. The history of the economic regeneration of Africa is not a new one. It has always sat in the inner recesses of the hearts and minds of our forebears. When Marcus Garvey, those many years, founded the Black Star, and told Africans to go back to Africa, he was remembering the need to come back home. He discovered that when you go out there and you imagine that the grass is green on the other side, the truth is that it's green on the other side because it has been watered. And we too are now saying that the grass on this side can be greener, but we must water it. So, we have come here, and our echo is ADDI, and in ADDI, we have water in it. And we want to water this grass on this side that it may become green. And I have no doubt in my mind that when we are involved in an initiative such as this, it is important that we remember our history. And our history tells us that Africans throughout the ages have always reminded themselves that we have a duty to grow Africa. Mm-hmm. I remember those days, cutters of history of Marcus Garvey. I remember the great African American John Henry Clark, yes, who said that Africa will never grow if she mimics others. Woo! Africa will only grow the day that she recognizes that in her womb resides our ability to resuscitate ourselves. I remember the words of the great South African John Judge Pixley Kaiser Kaseme, who was speaking on the fifth day of April 1906 in the United States of America under a title of a speech called The Regeneration of Africa, said, Africa is capable of making herself great again, but only if our sons and daughters make a solemn vow that it can be done. Today, I see that that solemn vow has been taken. We have crossed the Rubicon of merely saying what we want to do, and we are on the other side doing what we must do. And the presence of Africans from different and diverse backgrounds drawn from the diaspora is indicative of the fact that it is not business as usual, it is business as usual. And if it is business as usual, it means that we must do things that are going to change Africa in a dramatic way. And once again, Ghana is the place. I do not know how good students of history you are. And I do not know that you remember here in Ghana, in 1958, African leaders met under the chairmanship of Osagie for Kwame Nkrumah. They met in Accra and said, we must make Africa work. We must make Africa work because it is our duty. Having regained our political independence, the next battle is to regain economic independence. And it did not stop there. In 1960, once again in Casablanca, Morocco, he said, Africa must move in the direction of economic liberation. And it did not stop there. In 1963, on the occasion of the establishment of the Organization of African Unity, he was as enthusiastic as he was impatient when he told Africans, let us not leave here without a unit that is going to give us economic liberation. They listened to him not. And 50 years down the line, in the year 2013, Africans assembled in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, Her Excellency will remember, and they all apologized to the Osagie, for they said, you are right, you are wrong. Today, we have come here partly to atone for our own sins of omission and goodness. And we have come here to say that indeed we can do it. We have come here to demonstrate that we can doubt no more, and that our duty is to do what we must. We have come here to tell ourselves that the duty is intergenerational and that we are merely paying our part. And we have come here in the Cape Coast because we know this was the beginning of the pain which will lead to gain. We have come here in order to rededicate ourselves. We have spoken for too long. We have mourned for too long. We have philosophized for too long. We have intellectualized for too long. We have moralized for too long. The time for action is now. And I have not asked that this is going to be. You know, under the aegis of the African Union, we have an organization which in many ways is in a suspended space, state of animation, in comatose. But we can inject some steroids into our community. Yes. We can pick up Africa Agenda 2063 and give meaning to it. Yes. We can pick up the African continental free trade area and put some meaning into it. Yes. When I look at the men and women who are here assembled, I can now say that I have not had I can now say that to the extent that you have crossed oceans, to the extent that you are sacrificed, I have no doubt. I can say that we can no longer afford the luxury of doubt. We must have confidence. And that is why when I see my sister Arikana Kihombe-Rikwao and the men and women who are working with her organization, and when I hear that ADDI is mutating, not like COVID-19, but mutating differently, in Chad, and from Chad in Malawi, and from Malawi, and when all is said and done, my good friend, the Nigerian Adebayo, who talks about the curse of Berlin, will have to remind the book and say, this is not the curse of Berlin, it is the blessing of Berlin. Because all borders will be closed, and we shall move, and we have my sister. Oh, angels no longer come in the splendor that they did in the days of old. They come in the manner in which you are. They come in the manner in which you are present here. And I have no doubt that we have an angelic mission to change the continent of Africa. And change Africa we will. When I see the traditional rulers moved as they are to be present in our midst, I have no doubt. When I see you, Nana, I have no doubt that you'll give us all the land that we want. I have no doubt that you'll give us the tax holidays that we need. When I see you all present, I have no doubt that you will give us the energy that you will. And you have my sister say, we come here not to beg, but to give. Yes. And we come here to give because we have a duty to the mother continent.
Yes.
The mother continent needs and we shall give.
Yes.
Godless. Yes.